protector, and you are my provider and my deliverer. There's no other help by
Stevie B's Media Production presents What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. This show is dedicated to spreading the truth of God's Word, rightly dividing the Word of Truth. Feel free to give us a call while we're on the air tonight at 713-955-0508. If you would like to email us your comments or questions, you can do that at email srbutler1009@yahoo.com. Or you can also contact me at my business line at 910-425-1922. Ladies and gentlemen, this show is brought to you by loving and faithful members of the Churches of Christ around the world. If you need help locating a congregation in your area, please feel free to give us a call or send us an email, and we'll be happy to assist you. Now again, take out your Bibles and follow along with us, because you're listening to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler.
I really love the Lord.
Wiggins, pray that you will continue to bless him in his efforts to sow the seed of the kingdom And we pray that you'll bless our listeners as they listen to this broadcast, and we pray that they may listen well. We pray that something may be said that will cause them to consider their eternal stance before you and their soul salvation. Father, we thank you so much for Jesus and all that he means to us in this life and the life to come. We thank him for his precious sacrifice on Calvary. But we recognize without such a sacrifice, we would not even have a hope of eternal life. Father, we pray that you'll continue to bless us and love us and keep us all the days of our lives. And if we have been faithful unto death, Father, we pray that you would save us. For it's in Christ's name we do ask it all. Amen. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to welcome you to What a Word from the Lord. I'm your host, Stevie R. Butler. Now, I want to apologize. I may sound like I'm talking on a 1940s microphone because my studio went out on me just before I went on the air, so I'm talking on my Plan B microphone, so hopefully we can get these technical difficulties worked out before the show ends tonight. But we're going to do the best we can, but I just want to thank you for your love and support for this broadcast. Got a great show lined up for you tonight. My special guest speaker, as I said in the first segment, will be one of my co-hosts I used to work with on Five Guys in the Bible radio show, Joe Wiggins. I want to thank him for coming on the broadcast and sharing a word with us on this evening. And in the community corner, we have two special guests in the community corner tonight. We have Alex Lewis, he's the director for the YMCA here in Hope Mills, North Carolina, and Aretha Cleveland. She works for a nonprofit. I'm looking forward to hearing their presentations in the community corner on the broadcast tonight. And then, of course, my co-host, Edward Bishop. He's going to have the third segment of the broadcast. He'll be bringing us a lesson from the Word of God. And then I'll be closing out the show with a lesson from the Word of God as well. So thank you all for tuning in to What a Word from the Lord. Open your Bibles now and open your minds, and let's have a great show. After this song, the next voice you hear will be that of my special guest speaker, Joe Wiggins.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
Oh, happy day.
When Jesus was.
Oh,
and live rejoicing. day.
You're listening to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. Now my special guest speaker, Joe Wiggins, and his subject, Bringing Our A-Game, Why We Must Always Bring Our Best to God.
Thank you so much, Stevie, and thank you to everyone who is listening to us tonight, morning, afternoon, wherever it may be, somewhere in the world. We appreciate you always coming to an opportunity to hear the Word of God being proclaimed by one of his ministers. My name is Joe Wiggins. I am the minister and one of the elders at the Northeast Church of Christ in sunny San Antonio. We always welcome visitors to our congregation, so if you ever find yourself in the San Antonio area for visiting or friendship or perhaps to visit someone in the military, we would always be welcome and glad to see you drop by our congregation. As Stevie had announced, the title of my lesson is Bringing Our A-Game. And the reason I selected that title as well as that lesson is because whenever a preacher has an opportunity to speak to a group of people one time, it's always a special time. And it's always a challenging time because we always wonder, what can I say to the audience in one lesson that will help make a difference in their lives? It's different from when I get to stand before my congregation. I'm privileged to do so every Sunday morning. And so being a guest here on this program, I want to bring you a lesson that I hope will challenge you, inspire you to think, and most of all, dig into the Word of God to see the lesson that we are bringing, the points that we are bringing to you today. What I want you to understand is that we must always give our best efforts because of who Satan is and what he is capable of doing. Now, Satan himself will not tell you his true nature. For example, to show that he is incapable of showing his true nature, I want us to compare two different scriptures together. The first one is found in Job chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. And as always, I want to encourage everyone to turn in your own Bible and read these scriptures for yourself because, hey, you know, I'm human. I could make a mistake, but I don't intend to do so. But it is very important for you as a student of the Bible to open your copy of the Word of God and study it for yourself. So here's what we find in Job chapter 1, verses 6 and 7. On the day the angels came to present themselves before the Lord, and Satan also came with them, the Lord said to Satan, "Where have you come from?" Satan answered the Lord, "From roaming throughout the earth, going back and forth in it." Now keep Satan's statement in mind there as we look over in 1 Peter chapter 5 and verse 8 and compare what he has to say there. Peter says, "Be alert and of sober mind. Your enemy the devil prowls around like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." You see, Satan left that part out of Job chapter 1, and he was talking directly to God there himself. So Satan's nature is to walk around, see who can find to be his next victim, and take that person into his evil ways of doing things and into his kingdom. So we must understand, first of all, that Satan lies. We saw here in Job chapter 1 where he couldn't even answer God truthfully. But Peter, thankfully, inspired by the Holy Spirit, told us what his true nature was about. He's running around looking for someone that he can devour. Also, Satan has no compassion and will never give you or anyone else a break. Our next scripture is going to come from Matthew chapter 4, and we're going to start reading in verse 1. And as you're turning over there, I'd like for you to consider something. This is a challenge that I put out to many people, and I have never had anyone come back and answer this challenge because I already know the answer to the challenge. I want to challenge you to think of any place in the Bible, Old Testament or New Testament, where Satan has ever blessed or helped anyone. Now be thinking about that as we go to Matthew chapter 4 and start reading in verse 1. Then Jesus was led by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. After fasting 40 days and 40 nights, he was hungry. The tempter came to him and said, "If you are the Son of God, tell these stones to become bread." Now just think about this situation here for a minute. You know, if Stevie came to me, if he were coming over to my house today and say, you know, we're going to move some boxes or chop some firewood or something, and he shows up to my house and he's hot, he's sweaty, he's tired, and I say, "Stevie, what in the world happened?" "Well, man, I had a flat tire on the way over here, and I thought I'd never get those lug nuts loose and the new tire back on. It just nearly killed me." Well, Stevie, sit down, man. Have a glass of water. Rest. I mean, the boxes could be moved later. I'm not going to take Stevie at his weakest point when he's tired, when he's thirsty, when he's already run down, and then put him to work. Now, we don't do that to each other as human beings. That's just normal, everyday human kindness. And yet here Satan is, he's seeing Jesus at his weakest moment after he's been fasting for 40 days and 40 nights, and the very first thing he does when he comes to Jesus is he tempts him with food. So I want you to understand the context of this. Satan is always going to be looking to catch you at your weakest moment, at your weakest time. He's going to look to see what is your weakness. And your weakness may be different from mine. This is why it's very important for you to always bring your A game and for me to always bring my A game. So I want you to consider this and be inspired to bring your time, your talents, all of your energy to the Lord's work every single opportunity you have to do so. Now, this is unlike the normal day-to-day living that we do. For example, when you get home from work, if you're like me, you probably like to unwind and relax a little bit. You probably don't plan on doing the same thing at home that you were doing at work. Now, there's a few exceptions to that. But for the most part, we like to disconnect and unwind and do something different, both mentally and physically for a while. But as Christians, it's very important that we always stay connected to the Word of God, to the will of God, to the inspiration and the example that Jesus has provided for us. Because unlike our regular day-to-day jobs that we use to pay the bills and put food on the table, this job is different. This job is 24/7. And I hope that after we've had this study together today, you will start to see why how important this is. Now, after Jesus defeated the devil, and I did not go on and continue reading in Matthew chapter 4 because most of us know how that turns out. Jesus defeated Satan's temptation every single time, and he did it by using and following the Word of God. So we know how the story turns out, but I just wanted you to see the context of how Satan wanted to come to Jesus when he was at his weakest possible moment to tempt him. Now, after Jesus defeated Satan, he went on to describe him to us, to his disciples, to his followers. This reading is found in John chapter 8, beginning in verse 31. And I hope you'll follow along and read this, because this is one of the frankest, bluntest discussions that Jesus ever had with the people that he was trying to minister to and reach with the Word of God. John chapter 8, starting in verse 31, starts like this. To the Jews who had believed him, Jesus said, "If you hold to my teaching, you really are my disciples. Then you will know the truth, and the truth will set you free." They answered him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been slaves of anyone. How can you say that we should be set free?" Now I want to stop at the reading here just for a moment for you to see how blinded these people were to their own circumstances. As descendants of Abraham, they had certainly been slaves. That was the whole point of praying to God for 400 years for him to send them a deliverer, and God sent them Moses. And yet here they are, hundreds of years later, saying, "We've never been slaves of anyone." So they're not even being honest to themselves. Well, I want you to be honest with yourself. I want all of us to be able to be honest with ourselves at all times. Continue with our reading in verse 34. Jesus replied, "Very truly, I tell you, everyone who sins is a slave to sin. Now, a slave has no permanent place in the family, but a son belongs to it forever. So if the son sets you free, you will be free indeed. I know that you are Abraham's descendants, yet you are looking for a way to kill me because you have no room for my word. I am telling you what I have seen in the Father's presence, and you are doing what you have heard from your father." Now, pay attention here. This is going to get real close and personal. Verse 39. "Abraham is our father," they answered. "If you were Abraham's children," said Jesus, "then you would do what Abraham did. As it is, you're looking for a way to kill me, a man who has told you the truth that I heard from God. Abraham did not do such things. You're doing the works of your own father." "We are not illegitimate children," they protested. "The only father we have is God himself." Jesus said to them, "If God were your father, you would or I have come here from God. I have not come on my own. God sent me. Why is my language not clear to you? Because you are unable to hear what I say. You belong to your father, the devil, and you want to carry out your father's desires. He was a murderer from the beginning, not holding to the truth, for there is no truth in him. When he lies, he speaks his native language, for he is a liar and the father of lies. So this is Jesus laying it out for us. Satan has incredible power. Satan has great tools and great tricks. In fact, I like to remind people, a lot of people, when they've been a Christian for a while, 10, 20, 30, maybe even 50 years, they want to sort of feel like, you know, I've seen it all, done it all. I don't think Satan can try anything that I'm not ready for. And I want to tell you that that's a bad argument. That's a bad position to put yourself in mentally, because we may have been a Christian for 30, 40, 50 years or even longer, but Satan has been doing his game for thousands of years. He is the master, and we should never, ever, ever forget who he is and what he is and how good he is at doing it. Also, I want you to understand that Satan has no love for any person, but wants to destroy us. His game, his desire, his intent is to bring down every single one of us as quickly and as efficiently as he can. I turn you now over to Revelation chapter 12, beginning in verse 7. Now, before I get into this reading, I got to tell you, and a lot of people already know this, you have to be careful when you're reading Revelation. There's a lot of symbolic language there. Once you get past the first three chapters where Jesus was speaking directly to the seven churches of Asia, there's a lot of symbolic language in there. And a lot of people want to read the symbolic language in the book of Revelation and attach their own interpretation to it. We have to be very careful with that. But here in Revelation chapter 12, beginning in verse 7, I think the meaning of the words here are very self-explanatory. Then the war broke out in heaven. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon, and the dragon and his angels fought back. But he was not strong enough, and they lost their place in heaven. The great dragon was hurled down, that ancient serpent called the devil, or Satan, who leads the whole world astray. He was hurled to the earth, and his angels with him. Then I heard a loud voice in heaven say, "Now have come the salvation and the power and the kingdom of our God, and the authority of its Messiah. For the accuser of our brothers and sisters, who accuses them before our God day and night, has been hurled down. They triumphed over him by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony. They did not love their lives so much as to shrink from death. Therefore rejoice, you heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth and to the sea, because the devil has gone down to you. He is filled with fury because he knows that his time is short." So see the characteristics of Satan here. He will stand toe-to-toe with God and even stand against God himself. He has already lost the battle, and he already knows that he's going to lose the war. We'll talk about that in just a moment. But I want you to see here that he stands before God day and night, accusing us, tempting us, trying to destroy the world because he has stood against God and has failed. This is the guy that we're fighting. This is our enemy. Now, for those of you that don't know me, I spent 32 years in the military and working for the military. And back when I first went in the military, there was a country in existence called the Soviet Union. We had to be aware every day of what the Soviet Union was up to. We had to be aware every day that the Soviet Union was looking for an opportunity to go to war against the United States. And although most Americans don't know this, we could never take that for granted, those of us that wore the uniform. We called it being ever vigilant and prepared. And Satan is the same way, only 1,000 times worse. He's not trying to destroy cities and towns and nations. He's trying to destroy souls. But Satan has one crucial weakness. I alluded a moment ago to the fact that Satan knows that he will lose. And I want to bring that even more clearly into focus here. So let's go over to James chapter 2 for a moment. And I hope you're enjoying this lesson and taking the time to follow along in your Bible with us, because as we go to James chapter 2, I think we're going to see another very important point in this lesson about why it's so important for Christians to always bring their A game. James writes here when he says, starting in verse 18, "Someone will say, 'You have faith, I have deeds. Show me your faith without deeds, and I will show you my faith by my deeds.' You believe that there is one God, good. Even the demons believe that and shudder." And what James is trying to show to us here is that we can never be sufficient or satisfied or happy just with one. He was trying to show that both faith and deeds are necessary if we're going to win this battle. And he uses the contrast to compare our faith or our belief with the fact that even the demons know that God is real. And they shudder because, as we read a moment ago in Revelation chapter 7, they know that they are going to lose. He knows that he's going to lose the war. The next thing we need to understand is to know that Satan can be defeated, and showing his love and obedience, Jesus gave his best for us and gave us the tools to defeat Satan at his game. I want to encourage you to be turning over to John chapter 10 as we get ready to our next scripture reading in just a moment. But understand that Jesus was from the beginning of time preparing and prepared to be the Lamb that would take away the sins of the world, as well as the one that would then show us how to win the same battle that we are fighting every day. You may remember that when John the Baptist first saw Jesus coming from afar, he said to his disciples and his friends, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sins of the world." Well, something very miraculous, very incredible has happened with Jesus. He started out being our Lamb of God to take away the sins of the world, and he then became our shepherd to protect us as his sheep. This is an amazing transformation that was only possible through the power of God himself, because this is the message and this was the reason that he sent Jesus for us. And so he's given us many other things that we can come to understand as well. I want us to turn now over to John chapter 10 for a moment. And let's see something else that's very interesting here. A lot of people think, you know, well, it's hard being a Christian. It's not fun being a Christian. I want to remind you of something that came from Jesus himself, because he wanted us to understand that he was not here to bring us down. He was here to, in fact, build us up. Starting in John chapter 10, beginning in verse 12, when Jesus spoke again to the people, he said, "I am the light of the world. Whoever follows me will never walk in darkness, but will have the light of life." The Pharisees challenged him. "Here you are appearing as your own witness. Your testimony is not valid." Jesus answered, "Even to my own testify on my own behalf, my testimony is valid, for I know where I came from and where I am going." This is very important for you, Christian, to understand. We're not following a message that was cut out of a block of stone. We're not following a god or a symbol of a god that was cast with man's hands out of a piece of gold. We are following an immortal Messiah that has come to this world, shown us what we need to have eternal life, and then was returned to sit on the right hand of God. In fact, earlier in the scriptures, Jesus reminded us that he was in fact here to give us life, because in John chapter 10, and verse 10, he gave us some words that I think are very inspirational, and they are inspirational to me, and I hope they are to you as well. He said, "The thief only comes to kill and destroy. I have come that they may have life and have it to the full. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd lays down his life for the sheep." And so Jesus has reminded us, both with his words and his example, of what he came here to do and how he is here and still here in spirit to protect us. He nurtures us. He watches after us. Jesus gave us the formula and the recipe to move us closer to God. Many people don't know this because they don't understand the big picture, if you will. But the big picture in God's sight has always been to move man closer back to him. If you think about the beginning, God created this incredible Garden of Eden where man had everything he needed to thrive and do very well in the garden. But it was sin that caused him to leave and lose the blessings that were in the Garden of Eden. And there's something very special about the Garden of Eden, the tree of life, is that they would eat of the tree of life and live forever in a sinful condition. So in Genesis, the tree of life disappeared. You don't anymore until the latter part of the book of Revelation. And there it shows us that the tree of life is in heaven, and we will be able to partake of the fruit throughout all eternity. This is the grand plan for God to return us without sin to a close and personal relationship with him. And Jesus is the recipe to help us understand how to do that. Now, some will fail. Unfortunately, this is a reality that Jesus warned us about as well. if you would be turning over to Matthew chapter 7, and this is a very important scripture for everyone to understand, Christians as well as people who are thinking about becoming a Christian or may think that they are already a Christian. You know, I like to remind people, a lot of people are walking around, they never go to church, they never read their Bible, but they call themselves a Christian. They have been led to believe that they're okay in their spiritual state, that their spiritual relationship with God is just fine. They may even be doing some things every once in a while in the name of God. But we need to make sure that we are following Jesus' recipe for salvation and not our own ideas. In Matthew chapter 7, Jesus was talking about true and false prophets and true and false disciples and people that thought they were saved but would find out tragically that they are not saved. And in Matthew chapter 7, verse 21, he says, "Not everyone who says to me, 'Lord, Lord,' will enter the kingdom of heaven, but only the one who does the will of my Father who is in heaven." Now, you remember a moment ago when we were reading from John chapter 8, Jesus was telling those people there, "I am telling you what I have heard, and I am telling you, describing to you what I have seen," and they could not believe him. Jesus is saying here that the only people that will enter the kingdom of heaven are those that do the will of his Father as he has described and given to us. So, here's the solution then. If you want to go to heaven, and I certainly hope you do, then we can learn how to do this. We can and we must take the steps to give our best effort. And it's not that hard to do. Jesus has not made this complicated. You know, one of the things I hear people say every once in a while is that it's hard to understand the Bible. But I want to tell you, the Bible is easy for us to understand if we open it up and read it. In fact, some biblical scholars have said that the average education of the person that the Bible was written to in the New Testament, that the New Testament was written for, had approximately a third grade education. Now, if those people could read the scriptures and understand and do God's will, then how could we possibly, in our worst imagination, in the worst scenario imaginable, say today, that we cannot understand what the Word of God has to say? We can understand it. And in the few moments I have remaining, I want to leave you with a few thoughts. First of all, it is very important for you to be connected to God's people. There's a scripture in Hebrews chapter 10 that I've heard Christians quote, and quite frankly, I think some people misunderstand what Hebrews chapter 10 is saying. We're going to read a rather long selection of here, starting in Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 19. Now, some people read Hebrews chapter 10 and verse 25, saying, "Not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching." They sometimes, I think, erroneously teach other Christians that this means we have to go to church. And I want to tell you something, quite honestly, you don't have to do anything. I know before I get in the pulpit every Sunday morning, I cannot make anyone do anything. And I certainly can't do it now over a radio signal or through the internet. But what I can hope to do is to motivate you, to inspire you to want to do God's will. Because if you can be inspired by God's will, then no one will have to force you to attend services or be a part of God's kingdom, God's family, and to worship with his people. You will want to do that. Here's what we read when we come to a better understanding of Hebrews chapter 10, starting in verse 19. "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way open for us through the curtain, that is, his body. And since we have a great priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And let us consider how we may spur one another on towards love and good deeds, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging as you see the day approaching." You see, if you're inspired to want to be a part of God's kingdom, then the best place to be a part of God's kingdom is with members of the kingdom, to come together with Christians, to sing together, pray together, study together, worship together, and share in all the blessings that we enjoy as members of the body of Christ. This is what we can do, but we must decide to be committed, to bring, as I said earlier, to bring our A game, to be committed to God and his promises, so that we can hear those words one day that we are all hoping to hear. Well done, good and faithful servant. Come and enter the rest that's been prepared for you. Thank you so much for your time today listening to me, and thank you to Stevie for inviting me to be a part of this program. I'm going to turn the microphone back over to him now, and once again, thank all of you for being a part of tonight's show.
I'll be with the Lord.
I'll be with the Lord.
Through the valley of death,
through the valley of death,
I'm sure I must go,
I'm sure I must go.
So the wages of sin,
so the wages of sin,
I don't want to know,
I don't want to know.
I'll be judged by the deed,
I'll be judged by the deed,
and the seed I have sown,
and the seed I have sown.
And I'll live with my Savior,
and I'll live with my Savior,
while the ages roll on
and on,
while the ages roll 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 on.
I'll be with my Lord,
I'll be with my Lord,
while the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on.
The ages roll on,
while the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on.
I'll be with my Lord,
I'll be with my Lord,
while the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on.
The life I have lived,
the life I have lived,
and the path I have trod,
will be pleasing to God,
when I stand at His throne,
when I stand at His throne.
I know I won't be alone,
I know I won't be alone,
'cause I'll be with my Savior,
'cause I'll be with my Savior,
while the ages roll on
and on,
while the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on.
While the ages roll on,
while the ages roll on,
I'll be with my Lord,
I'll be with my Lord.
While the ages roll on,
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 while the ages roll on.
The announcements for the events and activities in the Churches of Christ. If you would like to have your events or activities announced on this broadcast, please contact me at 910-425-1922 or send me an email to srbutler1009@yahoo.com. On October the 1st through the 4th, 2018, the Southeastern Lectureship 2018 be hosted by the West Oak Grove Church of Christ. And that address is 3455 Highway 51 South, Hernando, Mississippi, 38632. For hotel information and registration, please contact the Ministry Evangelist Terry D. Wallace, Sr. at telephone number 662-449-4191. On May the 19th through the 24th, 2018, the 2018 Churches of Christ National Lectureship will be held in Greensboro, North Carolina, and the theme will be the exposition of the race by faith, and the text used will be Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2, hosted by the ministry evangelist Jefferson Carruthers at the Carver Road Church of Christ in Winston-Salem, North Carolina, with the other congregations in the Triad area, Greensboro, High Point, and Winston-Salem, North Carolina. The event will be held at the Connery Convention Center of the Sheraton at Four Seasons, and that address is 3121 Westgate City Boulevard, Greensboro, North Carolina, 27407. For more information, please call 336-292-9161. On May the 5th and the 6th, 2018, the 64th Annual Homecoming Celebration will be at the Church of Christ at Newtown. And that address is 2615 Duplex Road, P.O. Box 124, Spring Hill, Tennessee, 37174. The ministry evangelist is LeGarrett Herb Davis. And on Saturday, May the 5th, there will be a picnic at 10:30 a.m. to 2:30 p.m. There will be a song fest at 4 o'clock p.m. On Sunday, May the 6th, there will be morning worship service at 10:30 a.m. Be lunch will be served at 12:30 p.m. And Sunday afternoon worship at 2:30 p.m. On June the 3rd through the 8th, 2018, there will be a gospel meeting at the Rolling Addition Church of Christ. And that address is 3425 Morrison Street, Longview, Texas, 75602. And 03-753-0516. And just a reminder, tune in to Stevie B's Media Production Presents. We're airing live shows here on Blog Talk Radio. You can also hear the on-demand episodes if you can't catch the live shows with some of my affiliates on iHeartRadio, iTunes, YouTube, ACARadio.net, iWave Radio, MCCBroadcasting.com. Will be airing my shows Monday through Friday at 10 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You can also hear the affiliates World of Acapella and coming soon to Spotify. On Tuesday night, I'm hosting a live show from 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 5 to 7 p.m. Central Standard Time. What a Word from the Lord, with your host, Stevie R. Butler, radio show. And on this broadcast, I have guest speakers each week. We also have a new segment, The Community Corner, and my co-host, Edward Bishop, will be bringing lessons from the Word of God as well. And then on Thursday night, I'm hosting a live show from 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 5 to 7 p.m. Central Standard Time, the Gospel Light radio show. And on that broadcast, I have seven co-hosts who are presenting lessons from the Word of God. And on each week, two co-hosts presents lessons each week. I don't want you to think seven co-hosts of speaking all on one show. And also we have the question, shouted out portion of the broadcast. I'm taking some questions from my social media platform, shouted out. I bring two questions from that platform and I pose them to my co-hosts each week on the broadcast as well. And then on Friday night, I'm hosting a live show from 6 to 8 p.m. Eastern Standard Time and 5 to 7 p.m. Central Standard Time, Stevie B's Acapella Gospel Music Blast radio show. And on this broadcast, the first week, I'm interviewing artists, debuting new music, featuring old music in the Story Glory segment. Then the second week, my daughter Tati B, she's co-hosting that show. And the third week, I'm doing my Top 20 Countdown show. And the fourth week, we're doing the Talent Search show. You got 60 seconds to stand on the world stage and sing your song. First and second place prizes will be awarded. And once a quarter, we are doing the marathon show. So whatever artist or group that is on that broadcast, we are playing just their music on the program. And I'd like to welcome my new affiliate, IVCBroadcasting.com. They'll be airing the blast on Wednesday night at 9 p.m. Eastern Standard Time, 8 p.m. Central Standard Time. And that will conclude our announcements.
I know.
What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. Now, this is a new segment I have on the broadcast called the Community Corner, and the reasoning behind this segment, you know, sometimes there's a lot of people come to the church looking for help, and we can't always help them because we have to tell them this is not a work of the church. But there are folks who are sitting in our congregations who are doing great things for our community. So we want to know what it is that they're doing so that people can get the help that they seek that's outside of the realm of the work of the Lord's church. That's what this segment is all about. And since I have started this segment on the broadcast, we have had all kind of people coming through this program. We've had people in legal services, folks working in financial services. There's a sister that came through that has started a school for autistic children. We've had people working in disaster relief. So all kind of things that are being done among our congregations that we just want to know what you're doing. So that's what this segment is all about. So on tonight's broadcast, I have two guests in the Community Corner tonight. We have Aretha Cleveland. She's going to be my first guest in the Community Corner. How you doing, Aretha?
Good evening. I'm doing great. How are you doing today?
Doing just fine. I am on my grind on a Tuesday night. Now, I'm going to give you the floor.
That's great.
You go ahead and get your presentation.
Okay. Well, I like the way you put that when you have people sitting right there in the congregations who are doing great things for the community. And a lot of times we don't know. So I'm going to make sure that everybody that's listening tonight know what I'm doing in the community with my board members at Winning the Battles in Your Mind. Winning the Battles in Your Mind is a 501c3 nonprofit, Stevie, that we educate, advocate, and we raise funding for children with life-threatening diseases. You would think that you wouldn't have to do that, but the disease that we are working on now is sickle cell disease. And as I tell everybody, as I learn more, I distribute more. Well, with sickle cell disease, you can have a child who is in the hospitalized, which they are in the hospital a lot, especially with the weather changes. It puts them into a sickle cell crisis. They're there, their parents are there, and they miss a lot of school. But the hospitals here where I live doesn't have the funding to help the parents out when they're in the hospital. We just had a parent who was in the hospital for over 20-something days with her son, who went from being in a regular room to ICU back to a regular room. Well, their meals are not covered. Their parking is not covered. And so where we may say, oh, parking doesn't cost that much, you can take them a meal or they can get a meal. But imagine being in that hospital for over 20-something days and having to get breakfast, lunch, and dinner, having to pay for parking. So it's like, how can they do that if they're not working? And then when they go to the social worker, if their child had cancer, there's funding. So I asked the social worker, I said, why is that? And she said, because of you guys. I said, who are you guys? She said, the community. People donate for cancer. She said, but we rarely get any donations for sickle cell disease. So we took on the quest of being the face for sickle cell. This is our fifth annual gala for sickle cell disease that we're hosting here in Atlanta, Georgia, on Saturday, June the 23rd at the Cobb Gallery Center. And we will have families with children there. How many fundraisers do you go to, Stevie, to where you go to this fundraiser, you get a chance to dress up and look nice, have an awesome meal, and you actually get an opportunity to meet the children that you're raising the funds for? They are there, there front and center.
Oh, would you talk to me? Oh, I was going to
say,
put on a tux.
Oh. Well, whether you put on a tux or you put on a pair of nice jeans that was pressed and starched. How many fundraisers have you gone to and the children were right there for you to personally meet who you're raising funding for?
Good point.
So that's what we do. We do that within the battles in your mind. We bring those families out because it also helps them to do something that they don't often get an opportunity to do either. Just like you just said, but theirs is most of the time financial reasons or the fact that they're in the hospital with their children or a child, because I have some parents that deal with that have more than one child that has sickle cell disease. So therefore, we make it like a Cinderella night. And what we do is we ask the community, not just here in the Atlanta area, but I ask people nationwide to make a donation. And it's tax deductible because we are a 501c3. So I ask people to make a donation to help out. I mean, unfortunately, we've even had to use funding to help buy a headstone for a five-year-old who passed away from sickle cell disease. But the fact that we were still able to help, that's the valid point, is they could come to winning the battles in your mind. And I love the fact that we was blessed that name, winning the battles in your mind, because we are helping people to win the battles in their mind, pulling them away from the negative and helping them with the positive as they struggle and go through having a child with a life-threatening disease. So we're helping them to keep their focus on what's important, and that's being there, while we focus on helping them with the financial struggles or hardships that come along with being in the hospital so much with a child that has sickle cell disease. So that's what we do. Winning the battles in your mind, for those who see us on social media, that hear us on the radio, we are twofold. We are Winning the Battles in Your Mind University, where we teach women and we equip women with the information they need to go out to help save the lost. And we also have 5:30 and 6:30 prayer call. And then I also travel as a speaker. I don't say motivational speaker, Steve, I say game changer, because I believe in action. And when you're doing, putting forth action, not just speaking, you're truly changing the game. So I carry the title as Game Changer International Speaker. So thank you so much for being here tonight, and really would like to extend, if there's anyone listening tonight who would love to attend our Black Tie Gala here in the Atlanta area, 80% of our attendees are from a different state as well. They make a
now, Aretha, tell my listeners how they can contact you.
They can contact me, Stevie, I prefer for telephone call, good old-fashioned telephone call. They can call me at 770-309-3655. That's 770-309-3655. And for those, Stevie, who are busy, because you know we're in a tech-savvy world, they can always shoot me an email at Aretha@ArethaCleveland.com. Aretha@ArethaCleveland.com. And I'll be glad to get back with them.
The broadcast tonight, that was a great presentation. I certainly appreciate it.
Thank you so much for having me.
Now, ladies and gentlemen, I have two guests in the community corner tonight. I think I disconnected myself here for a minute. Yeah, I have two guests in the community corner tonight. The second guest I have is Alex Lewis. He is the director at the YMCA here in Hope Mills, where I live, and I have had a chance to meet Alex and see what he's actually doing there at the YMCA. So I invited him to come on the broadcast so he can share with my listeners what activities he has at the Y. How you doing, Alex?
Doing well, sir.
All right, my brother, you got the floor.
I appreciate your time this evening and how truly blessed we are. I'm with the YMCA at Sand Hills. For those who do not know, the YMCA is the Young Men's Christian Association. We're a nonprofit organization here in Cumberland County. We have served our community for over 120 years. We have three locations locally in the Fayetteville, Hope Mills area, one located on Ramsey Street, which is a 24-hour YMCA. We have one that's located on Fort Bragg Road in Fayetteville. That has an indoor pool, basketball court, of course, workout area, and aerobics classes. I manage and direct the operations of the Hope Mills branch, once again in Cumberland County. Every single YMCA in the world is different. We're not locally. We're across the nation. We're also located in every continent in the world. Young Men's Christian Association, we basically have our mission. Our mission is for the YMCA is to put Christian principles into practice through programs that build a healthy spirit, mind, body for all. You don't have to be a Christian to be a part of the YMCA, but our doors are open to anybody. regardless of what their religious beliefs are or personal beliefs or so on. Our doors are open to anybody. How do we serve the community? We're more than just a gym and swim. Where we do offer a health and exercise equipment, aerobics, exercise, aquatics, swim lessons, and so on. But not only do we offer that way to improve one's health and strength, but we also do more than that. We offer financial assistance for families who cannot afford a membership to a fitness center. We also offer child care, summer camp programs, after-school programs, and once again, those programs are scholarshiped and discounted for those who qualify. We impact primarily families and children. Our main goal is to bring a family together with our Christian principles directed by our YMCA. It's a great place to work. I've been affiliated many years with the Y. Before I was hired on, I served and volunteered my time with the YMCA. Volunteered my time with kids programs such as coaching, especially soccer, and I was able to be blessed to be able to coach my own boys, in fact, in the Y. Played many sports throughout my life, and my kids have too so far, playing with different leagues such as a rec or high school setting, college. What the Y does for their sports programs is a lot different. They take the time to not only develop the children with their fundamentals of the sports that they're trying to learn, but they also basically sit down with the children and talk about character development, our core values, which are caring, responsibility, respect, and being honest. So our programs for our children revolve around those core values. Like I said earlier, every YMCA is different. Whether it's located in a big city or suburbs or pretty much, like I said, in Cumberland County area. We serve the military, being in this area particularly, so which is a big difference compared to going to Florida or California and so on. Like I said, every YMCA is different. I've been truly blessed to be able to be part of the movement of the Y. I invite you to come down to any of our locations here in Cumberland County. Talk to me directly if you wish. We take volunteers for any of our programs that we do, and we do have summer employment for summer camp counselors and lifeguards. So please give me a call. Phone number is 910-426-9622. And my direct extension is 204 if you would like to talk to me, or you could just choose from any of our branches to talk to anybody about the Y. So I invite you to come down, be a part of our mission, and to bring your family and friends.
Well, Alex, I want to thank you for coming on the Community Corner. Great presentation. I certainly appreciate it.
I really appreciate your time, and I just want to say to everybody out there to have a blessed evening. And God bless each and every one of you.
All right. Thank you so much. Ladies and gentlemen, when we come back from the break, we'll have a lesson from my co-host, Edward Bishop. Thank you for tuning in to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler.
When God says no, and we won't listen to the
end, just remember,
don't forget.
Father knows, what's best. When I lay awake at night, with tears streaming from my eyes, I remember,
God
knows, what's best.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah, yeah, my God. In the midnight hour, I was crying and all alone, waiting for an answer on my own. you'll forsake me. Lord, where are you now? So I went to church the next Sunday morning, looking for my breakthrough. I knew a change would come if I just hold on, 'cause God's word is true. But then the preacher said something, and it took me by surprise. Sometimes God says no, but just like Job, you gotta trust him, my child. When God says no, but when the preacher said it, I didn't quite understand. He said, don't forget, just trust your Father, 'cause he knows what's best. When I lay awake in the middle of the night with tears streaming from my eyes, I remember Father knows, no matter what you're going through, God, 'cause he knows, God, he Father knows what's best. And I start to feel a little better, 'cause he started talking about my Jesus in the Garden of Gethsemane, and how we prayed to the Father, let this cup pass from me. Then he did just like me, y'all. Said he went to his best friend, and his friend let him down. He said, my God, why have you forsaken me? Where are you now? Sometimes God is moving and we don't understand. See, Jesus paid the cost when we were lost, and it was all a part of God's master plan. So when you're waiting for that answer and God says no to you, just go ahead and shout, hey, and have no doubt,
I trust your Father.
Father, I remember, no matter what it is or what it looks like, God, he knows, yes, he knows.
You're listening to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. Now my co-host, Edward Bishop, and his subject, when was the last time you've been to God's McDonald's?
Good evening. I would like to first of all once again thank Brother Butler for giving me an opportunity to present to you a lesson from God's engrafted word, which is able to save our soul. More importantly, above all, I thank the God of heaven for giving me the strength and the ability to be able to stand before you on this evening. For it's in him that we live, we move, and we have our very being. We are because he is. Our amness is simply wrapped up in his isness. Now, having said that, if you have your copy of God's engrafted word, which is able to save our very soul, God's basic instructions before leaving the book of Mark, the sixth chapter, verses 30-44. That's the book of Mark, the sixth chapter, verses 30-44. If you have it, it reads, And the apostles gathered themselves together unto Jesus and told him all things, both what they had done and what they had taught. And he said unto them, come ye yourselves apart into a desert place and rest a while. For there were many coming and going. They had no leisure so much as to eat by ship privately. And the people saw them departing, and many knew him, and went afoot thither out of all cities. And out went them and came together unto him. And Jesus, when he came out, saw much people and was moved with compassion toward them, because they were as sheep, not having a shepherd. And he began to teach them many things. And when the day was now far spent, his disciples came unto him and said, there is a desert place, and now time is far past. Send them away, that they may go into the country round about, into the villages, and buy themselves bread, for they have nothing to eat. He answered and said unto them, give ye them to eat. And they say unto him, shall we go and buy 200 penny worth of bread and give them to eat? He says unto them, how many loaves have ye? Go and see. And when they knew, they say, 5 and 2 fishes. He commanded them to make all sit down by 50 in the grass. And they sat down and ranged by hundreds and by 50. And when he had taken the 5 loaves and 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to his disciples to set before them. And the 2 fishes divided he among them, and they did all eat and were filled. And they took up 12 baskets full of fragments and of the fishes, and they did eat of the loaves, were about 5,000 men. I want to speak as the spiritual God, just briefly, with this thought implanted on our mind. When was the last time you've been to God McDonald's? When was the last time you've been to God McDonald's? McDonald's is one of the largest food chains in the world. McDonald's is known for its slogan, billions and billions being served. Long before McDonald's was giving out fish fillet sandwiches, God, the messianic master, Jehovah Jireh, the great I am, the prince of peace, the everlasting father, the almighty God, the I am that I am. We notice the messianic master was giving out fish free of charge. Unlike McDonald's, God did not charge for his giving out of the fish. McDonald, God's violence, the book of Luke, the 9th chapter, verses 10 through 17. John, the 6th chapter, verses 1 through 15. Matthew, the 14th chapter, verses 13 through 21. All those scriptures give account of the messianic master giving out fish free of charge. Oh, I'm so glad that our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ, he did not charge for his giving out of food. God saw a need. Our Lord and our God saw the folk were hungry, not only physically, but spiritually. And before God took care of the spiritual need, he took care how much you know, until they know about how much you care. God showed that he is a caring and loving and merciful God. He saw the need for the people. But not only did he see the need, feel their need. Oh, that's just like what we, as members of the body of Christ, ought to be doing. We ought to see folk who are in need, not only spiritually, but we see folk are in need physically, and we just walk on by. Before you can take care of spiritual needs, as members of the body of Christ, we need to first learn how to take care of folks' physical needs. Oh, there are folk out there who may be hurting physically. Oh, y'all don't hear me on this evening. When was the last time you went to God's McDonald's? When was the last time you saw folks' needs and took care of them? When was the last time you saw folks' spiritual needs? Oh, sometimes we have the tendency to see folk in need, and we just walk on by. The Bible tells me, show your faith with work, and I will show you my faith by my works. Oh, when was the last time you've been to God, McDonald's? I'm so glad for this radio broadcast in the community corner, because it lets us know in the world who needs our help. And as members of the body of Christ, the church of Christ, the church that is the pillar and the ground of truth, as members of that blood-bought institution, whenever we see a need, we ought to do like Jesus did and fulfill their need. Oh, when was the last time You've been to God. McDonald's is known for their French fries as salty as those fries are. They outsell most everybody's fries in the world. They sell more fries than Wendy's. They sell more fries than Burger King. They sell more fries than the majority of the fast food industry. But as salty as those fries are, our God, the messianic master, has called us to be salt of the world. Oh, how do I know? Let's look at Matthew, the 5th chapter, in verse number 13. Matthew, the 5th chapter, verse number 13, the Bible tells us, ye are the salt of the earth. Salt preserves. Salt is used in cooking. It marinates and seasons the meat. The Bible tells us that as members of the body of Christ, as Christians, Christian simply means ain't nothing without Christ. The Bible tells us that as Christians, we are the seasoning of the earth. We are the preservers of the earth. The Bible goes on to tell us, but if the salt, if we, as Christians, have lost our saltiness, then shall we be salty. The Bible tells us, then for we are good for nothing but to be cast out and be trodden under the foot of man. So my question again to you on this evening is, when was the last time you've been to McDonald's? If folk did not used to swear around you, but every now and then say those words they ought not be saying around you, if you have not been truly conformed, have truly been reformed by the renewing of your mind, my suggestion to you on this evening is for you to check out your saltiness. Check out to see if you have lost your saltiness. Oh, if you were on trial for being a Christian, would there be enough evidence to convict you? Oh, so if folk act differently around you than they did when you first became a member of the body of Christ, if folk talk differently than they did around you when you first became a member of the body of Christ, check out your saltiness. Because the fact of the matter is, you may have lost your saltiness. if you made me to visit God's McDonald's and get your saltiness back again. Oh, when was the last time you've been to God's McDonald's? McDonald's is known for its sweet tea. And anybody who know about McDonald's sweet tea, like I do, because that's one of the only reasons I go to McDonald's, is for this sweet tea. Those of us who know about this sweet tea know that McDonald's sweet tea is real sweet tea. Oh, but there is something worse. There is a God whose name is sweeter than a, whose name is that every name, every tongue is going to confess, and every tongue is going to bow before the name of Christ. Oh, I wish I had time to read these scriptures, so I'll just give it to you and you can read them at home. Psalm, the 119th chapter, verses 103. Proverbs, the 24th chapter, verse number 14. And Psalm, the 19th chapter, verse number 10. The thing about sweet tea is, after you drink it, you feel thirsty. The Bible tells us that in the book of John, the 4th chapter, verse number 19, John, the 4th chapter, verse number 14. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water, springing up to everlasting life. The Bible tells us, if you think of the water that Christ, that you shall never thirst again. John, the 6th chapter, verse number 35. John, number 35. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh unto me shall never hunger. And he that believeth on me shall never thirst. McDonald's has some of the softest buns, still get hungry. John, the 6th chapter, verse number 35. And Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. He that cometh to me shall never hunger. Oh, so my question to you for this evening is, are you eating and partaking from the bread of life, drinking from the water of the well? They will run if never, run if dry. So my question to you this evening is, when was the last time you've been to God's McDonald's? My last point. McDonald's is known for its Big Mac sandwiches, which include two beef patties, iceberg lettuce, American cheese, pickles, and onions. Special sauce, all on sesame seed bun. God has his special ingredient called the Holy Spirit. Acts 2nd chapter, verse number 38. Repent and be baptized, every one of you, in the name of Jesus Christ for the remission of sins. And God will give to you the Holy Spirit. Acts the 5th chapter, in verse number 32. God has promised the Holy Spirit to all those who have obeyed him. Look at Acts the 5th chapter, verse number 32. We are his witnesses of things, and so is also the Holy Ghost, whom God has given to them that obey him. Oh, I wish I had more time to get into that. But my question to you on this evening is, when was the last time you've been to God, McDonald's? My time is up for this evening. So at this time, I will turn the time back over to our good brother and host of the show, Brother Butler. Thank you for your time and your attention.
There may be someone
that may be going through some trials and tribulations in your life. Your nights are filled with crying eyes, and it may have been that way for a very long time. But sometimes you're wondering what the answer is. Maybe you don't know whether to go left, to go right, to go forward or go back. But sometimes you just got to get on your knees and fall down, pray to him. You just got to stand still and let God have his way. And watch him work.
Watch God work.
Watch him work. Yes, Lord.
Watch him make a way.
Watch him make a way. And one of these days, God is going to answer your prayers, not on your time, but on his time. He is going to make a way for you. Let the church say amen and amen one more time. Boom, you'll see a brighter day.
Are you going through the storm in your life? And you just don't know how you're gonna fight your fight. Are you having some dark nights? Oh, so dark that you can't even see the light. See, I've been there. Trust me, I know.
Till soon.
Wondering if I'll make it to tomorrow. I don't wanna have to go through it again. So let me share what I did. Oh yeah.
What did you do?
See, I got down on my knees and prayed.
Yes, I did.
Leaving all my worries and all my
cares. Trouble.
So I moved. Let him have his way.
Yes, Lord.
And in my days, I know I'll see a brighter day.
Just watch God work.
Watch him work.
Watch.
other side. I know you'll see a bright day. Oh, the Bible says your weeping may endure for a night, but joy, it's coming in the morning. Can I get a witness? Courage, my sister, it will be alright.
You're listening to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to continue with this four-part series that I've been discussing on the broadcast for the last few weeks entitled The Lord's Church. We talked about it in the first part of this series, how to become a member of the Lord's Church, and we also talked about what is involved in being a member of the Lord's Church. So on tonight, we want to look at placing membership in a congregation of the Lord's Church. Placing membership in a congregation of the Lord's Church. In our increasingly mobile society, Christians are often faced with a dilemma that can have eternal consequences, and that is, at which congregation should we worship? There are a number of questions that need to be asked when we move to a different location for whatever reason, or we decide to leave a congregation and go to another congregation for whatever reason. We need to ask ourselves, which congregations are sound in the faith? We need to ask ourselves, which congregations has the best leadership? We need to ask ourselves that, which congregation can me and my family grow the most? Ladies and gentlemen, we need to ask ourselves, which congregation offers me the greatest opportunities to serve? You know, I had a brother contact me just last night, and his issue with his congregation is that he can't serve. This brother wants to preach, and they won't let him preach. Well, that's another, I just thought I'd throw that out there. But ladies and gentlemen, these are real issues. But I want you to notice what's absent from this list of topics that I just gave. What's absent is how ornate or how elaborate is the building? What recreational programs are there for my children? Is this a church that has sufficient numbers so that I can blend in and not be noticed? Or is this a small church so that I can shine my light? Or do all the professionals or successful people go to this congregation? Ladies and gentlemen, you might be surprised at the second list, but realistically, there are some who would make these items a priority in selecting a place of worship. So the focus of The remainder of this lesson will be on the 3 points. Number one, what criteria should I use when choosing a place of worship among the Lord's body? Number two, ideas that should be eliminated from the aforementioned criteria. And then lastly, the necessity of placing membership. So let's look at number one, the first point I'd like to make from this lesson, and that is, what criteria should I use when choosing a congregation? Well, first, if there is a sound and faithful group meeting nearby, there are certainly many ways to determine if the local church near your home is a sound, faithful body of believers. Don't take the word of other members in the church. There are statements made by members of our area churches. Sometimes, ladies and gentlemen, you need to go look and check things out for yourselves. You might receive either ignorant or incorrect information. I had a brother on social media today making a statement about me that he heard from somebody else, and he apologized because he was not operating out of knowledge, but out of ignorance. And I certainly accepted his apology. So secondly, you should meet with their leadership and ask several questions. Ask them, are they scripturally organized with elders and deacons? You'd be surprised. A lot of congregations don't have scriptural organization, and they're not trying to get scriptural organization. Well, that's why you need to go and find out these things for yourselves. You need to ask them, are the elders and deacons qualified to be in their respective positions? See, a lot of times we just assume when we go to congregations and they have elders and deacons, we just assume that they are qualified, not really knowing how they got in these positions. Sometimes we need to ask these questions. We need to ask them, do they worship God in spirit and in truth, according to John 4 and verse 24? We need to ask them, are they actively involved in area evangelism? Ask these congregations, have they disciplined any members in the last 10 years by making or withdrawing fellowship? We need to ask them, are they financially solvent? We need to ask them, you might ask them their understanding of the application of Matthew 19, verses 1 through 9. Is its precepts and commands applicable to the entire world today? You'd be surprised at the answer you receive. You might want to ask them their understanding of the Holy Spirit. Is it miraculous? You need to ask them, are you actively involved? Are you actively involved in every member of the Lord's church, according to Romans chapter 12? Them, there might be many other questions or personal interests that might be posed. Ladies and gentlemen, it would be well for the leaders of every local congregation to inquire about the spiritual well-being of prospective members. In like manner, we ought to take the same precautions in investigating a potential church home. Which brings me to my second point of this lesson, why placing membership as a congregation of the Lord's church is so important. What criteria should be of my least concern? That's the second point of this lesson. What criteria should be of my least concern? Ladies and gentlemen, many churches fall prey to the idea that elaborate edifices or massive renovations to their meeting houses are the key to drawing new members or prospective members to their fellowship. They are bought into this fancy promotion by the movie. You remember this movie, The Field of Dreams? If we build it, they will come. It is easy to assume such when we see brethren flocking to churches with new building programs. The problem is that we may be under a false assumption. However, this should not be a criteria in choosing a place to worship. There is not one nail, brick, or 2x4 that can add to your relationship to the Lord. In the first century, the emphasis was placed highly on the action of preaching the gospel, not on where to meet and hold worship services. The upper room of the Passover, Mark 14 and verse 15, and the upper room where the apostles met in Acts chapter 1 and verse 13 were simply rooms constructed over a first floor to provide a cooler place to assemble or sleep at night. See Manners and Customs of the Bible Land by Frank Wright on page 40. Some great reading. Our desire to have elaborate and ornate buildings to worship might be like constructing an idol temple, or like Israel's desire to have an earthly king so they could show off to the surrounding nations. Another topic that seems to be important to some in selecting a congregation is pondering the question, what programs do you have in place, and what do you have for the kids? I've heard a lot of people actually say they left certain congregations to go to others because of the programs that they had for their children. Organization is important in the local church. The Apostle Paul tells us by inspiration that all things must be done decently and in order, 1 Corinthians chapter 14 and verse 40. However, things can be organized and yet not be alive. Behind the pulpit where I attend, there is a beautiful artificial flower arrangement. The flowers are most definitely organized, yet they are a delusion, a mirage of sorts. They are fake, but are organized to look like the real thing. Jesus Christ, our Lord, warned the church at Sardis that in Revelation chapter 3 and verse 1, that thou hast a name, that thou liveth and are dead. The Lord's church must be motivated by love and not propelled by programs. Ladies and gentlemen, it is every parent's wish that their children grow up to be loving, well-rounded adults. It is commendable to be interested in the social interactions of our young people with other Christians. And we should provide wholesome spiritual and enjoyable opportunities for this to occur. But the most important thing we can provide them with is a foundation of knowledge in the scriptures. The Bible school program is an excellent way to ground our children in the most holy faith. What more could you want for your children that would be of greater importance than seeing them obey the gospel and continue to live as faithful Christians? I have known brethren to decide to attend a Pacific church simply because of the size of the attendance. Some have expressed the desire to attend a large church so that they can blend in and not be easily noticed if they are absent. Others have, by their actions, chosen small churches so that they can feel important and seek recognition. Ladies and gentlemen, both of these extremes are shameful in light of what our Lord expects us in the way of service. We should do everything in our power to actively participate in every aspect of the local church. Which brings me to the last point of this lesson, and that is the necessity of placing membership. The question arises from time to time that asks concerning the necessity of placing membership. If a Christian is to follow the teachings of the New Testament, he must honestly conclude that he must be a part of a local congregation. And here are the reasons why. Number one, the church is the body of Christ, universally and locally. And as such, many of the New Testament letters were written specifically to the local body of Christ, i.e. the church. When these inspired writers communicated the blessings and promises to those in the church, you can see Philippians chapter 1, verse 1, 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 1 through 9. He was most certainly speaking to those who were a part of that local body. He was not speaking to all the inhabitants of Corinth when he addressed the issues of division, fornication, and miraculous gifts, etc. But Paul was speaking to the church at Corinth. In verse 9, he addresses those who were called unto the fellowship of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. If we are part of the body of Christ, the church, then we are to be a part of a local body that exists and fellowship with them. Number two, does not Paul, by inspiration, address problems existing in the local body in Corinth when there was problems with the uses of spiritual gifts during the public assembly? In chapter 12, verse 13, Paul says, "We are all baptized into one body." In the next verse, he says, "The body is not one member, but many." This not speaking exclusively about the local body. He continues to inform the necessity of all parts of the body working together and that there be no schisms or divisions in the bodies. Verse 25. Now, how then can you contribute to the effectiveness of the body of the church as instructed here by the Apostle Paul if you are not recognized as part of that body or the local congregation? Which brings me to my last point, and that is Hebrews chapter 13, verse 7. And verse 17 is clear that Christians are to obey them that have the rule over you and submit yourselves. If you are not recognized as a member of a particular body or congregation, you are not submitting yourselves to the direction of their leadership. This may be the very reason that many do not place membership at a local body or church, because they don't want to submit to anyone's authority. Yeah, I said it. If this is the case, then you are not following God's command to do so, and your soul is in jeopardy when you disobey God. Amen. The first thing I would want to do when considering a move to a new area or a new congregation would be to find a faithful body of believers before deciding the vicinity in which to live. I would not want to make distance to the building a hindrance to my level of service to God and His Son, Jesus Christ, or limit my ability to fellowship with His people. Amen. And I'll see you on the other side of the break.
I want to be like Jesus every day long.
Listening to What a Word from the Lord with your host, Stevie R. Butler. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the part of the broadcast I would like to extend to you the Lord's invitation. You know, it wouldn't do us any good to preach all these great sermons, give you all this good information, and then not tell you how to save your soul. If you are not a Christian, if you are not a child of God, one cannot be a child of God until you are a Christian. Don't let anybody tell you otherwise until you have been born again. As the Bible teaches, then you are lost outside of Christ. Ladies and gentlemen, you're not lost 100 years from now. You're lost right now. It's not enough to be religious. You must obey the commands of the Lord. In order for a man to be saved, you must take heed and answer the gospel call. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2 and verse 14. You must hear the gospel, John chapter 6 and verse 45, Romans chapter 10, verse 14 and 17. And the facts of the gospel are the death, the burial, and the resurrection of Jesus Christ. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 3. You must believe the same. Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 6, James chapter 2 and verse 24. You must repent. Luke chapter 13, verse 3 and 5, Acts chapter 17 and verse 30. You must confess your faith in Christ Jesus, Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, Matthew chapter 10, verses 32 and 33. You must be baptized in water for the remission or the forgiveness of your sins. Acts chapter 2 and verse 38, Acts 10 and verse 48, 1 Peter chapter 3 and verse 21. And if you are a Christian and you have not been faithful in your service to God, you can decide again by repentance and prayer, Acts chapter 8 and verse 22. And I want to encourage you to visit a congregation in your local community. The churches of Christ will be glad to have you and be glad to assist you in whatever need you may have. Amen. And I'll see you on the other side of the break.
Oh, yeah. I'll go. Oh,
gentlemen, I want to thank you for spending a little time with me on this broadcast this evening in a study of God's Word. I want to thank my special guest speaker, Joe Wiggins, for that great lesson he gave in the first segment. I want to thank those who came to the Community Corner as well, Aretha Cleveland and Alex Lewis, great presentations from them as well. I want to thank my co-host, Edward Bishop. He always does a fine job on this program. And I want to thank you all for tuning in to this broadcast. I pray that the things that you heard from the Word of God on this broadcast has been beneficial to your spiritual lives and that your relationship with the Lord has gotten that much stronger and that much better. And I pray God's continual blessings upon your lives as well. Good night, everybody. God bless you. I'll see you up on the other side.
Don't cry.
Sight,
yeah, yeah.
Away.
won't be.
Won't
be.
So
can't you see the joy? Can't you see? Can't you see the wonderful, wonderful land where?
Episode 67.